We'd like to now move into our second panel, which looks at regions and relationships. And I'm absolutely delighted to welcome five of my very best and brightest colleagues from the Coral Bell School to talk to us about various regions and relationships. The first speaker will be Dr. Joanne Wallace. Joanne is with the Strategic and Defence Studies Centre within the Coral Bell School. Her work has long looked at security issues in the Pacific. Second will be Dr. Nick Farrelly. Nick is with the Coral Bell School. He is coming off an ARC Early Career Researcher grant, and he looks particularly at Myanmar, but is a specialist across Southeast Asia as well. You already know Amy King. Amy is with the Strategic and Defence Studies Centre, and she will be looking at North Asia, China, Japan, Korea, Taiwan. To my left is Dr. Bina DaCosta. Bina is with our Department of International Relations, and she will be looking at South Asia, an area of particular research interest for her. And on the far left, physically if not politically, I would say, is Peter Dean. Pete is with our Strategic and Defence Studies Centre. He's a specialist on the Australia-US alliance, and he'll be talking about our relations with the United States. So without further ado, Joanne, if you could lead us off.
So Papua New Guinea and the Pacific Islands lie in close proximity to the north and east of Australia, across vital air and sea approaches that link us to our trading and defence partners in North America and Northeast Asia. Reflecting this, successive defence white papers have identified that a secure Papua New Guinea and Pacific Islands sits only behind a secure Australia in the hierarchy of our strategic interests. Now, we have vastly more material resources than Papua New Guinea and the Pacific Islands, and we've long viewed ourselves and been viewed by others as having a substantial and special responsibility in the region. Reflecting this perception, the Pacific Islands have been described as our patch, Australia's immediate neighbourhood, our near abroad, and our backyard. So over the last 20 years, the Pacific Islands have been the principal destination for Australian defence, policing and development assistance, as well as the site of our largest military interventions. Now, Australia's activism in the region has led to claims that Australia believes that it has a natural right to lead and to seek regional primacy. And the 1994 ANZAC Agreement, for example, has been read as implying that Australia and New Zealand could or should have a hegemonic influence in the region. Others have claimed that Australia is effectively already a great power or regional hegemon. Now, my current book project assesses how Australia has sought to exercise its influence in pursuit of its strategic interests in the region since 1975, which was the year that Papua New Guinea gained independence. And my emerging conclusion is that Australia has never been a regional hegemon, and actually we find it increasingly difficult to exercise our influence in the region. Over the past year, Australia has faced a number of challenges, and admittedly several of these are of our own making, to our role and relationships in the Pacific Islands. First, Australia faces challenges to our regional leadership from both within and outside the region. Within the region, Fiji continues to rejoin the Pacific Islands Forum, which is the most significant political and security institution in the region, unless Australia and New Zealand leave. And Australia had led the charge to have Fiji removed from the forum in 2009, following its military coup in 2006. Now, while the forum, despite Fiji's absence, remains the most important multilateral regional institution, our ability to influence its agenda is declining. And this is exemplified by the decision last year to abandon the Pacific Plan for Greater Regional Integration that Australia and New Zealand had been pushing for the last 10 years. And instead, it's been replaced by a framework for Pacific regionalism. And this has been produced as a result of much more consultation around the region and consequently reflects regional priorities as opposed to Australian ones. That not necessarily is a bad thing, but it is an example of how our influence over the agenda has changed. Challenges from outside the region come from increasingly active external powers, most notably China and Russia, but also including Japan, Korea, Indonesia, and India. The presence of these powers has widened the region's choice of external partners and has eroded our influence further. Indeed, the 2013 Defence White Paper acknowledged that, quote, attitudes to our role are changing in the region, quote, as the growing reach and influence of Asian nations opens up a wider range of external players for our neighbours to partner with. Second, reflecting Fiji's refusal to rejoin the forum, the regional order is evolving and Pacific Island states are creating or strengthening alternative regional and sub-regional institutions and organisations that explicitly exclude Australia, New Zealand and other traditional partners like the US. The most notable of these is a sub-regional Melanesian spearhead group. Now, while this shift has been encouraged initially by the Fijian military regime and subsequently by the now democratically elected Fijian government, it has been met with enthusiasm by other Pacific Island states who increasingly feel that Australia doesn't share their goals, with our approach to climate change being an obvious example here. Third, Papua New Guinea is an increasingly influential player, given its disproportionately large geographic, population, economic and military size compared to other Pacific Island states. And Papua New Guinea actually continues to expand its own aid program in the region. It was 300 million kina this year, which is about 150 million Australian dollars. And that's not necessarily comparable to ours, but it's sizable enough to gain influence. Our ability to exert influence over Papua New Guinea has been severely undermined by our reliance on it hosting the Manus Island Regional Processing Centre. We now have much less control over how our aid program is spent and much less ability to influence the Papua New Guinea government. And this was exemplified. There are numerous examples, but the most recent one that I can think of is the decision by the Papua New Guinea government to announce last year that to cancel all the contracts of Australians working as advisors in their government, that no more Australian advisors could work for their government unless they were employed directly as Papua New Guinea employees. Recently, just weeks before the Forum Trade Ministers meeting, that meeting actually happened a couple of days ago, at which the text of the PACER Plus regional trade agreement that Australia has been advocating for the past 5 years was agreed, Papua New Guinea publicly announced that it would not participate in the PACER agreement on the grounds that it didn't offer enough benefits to Papua New Guinea, and it was targeting its comments here at Australia. Our approach to processing and resettling asylum seekers in Papua New Guinea and Nauru has also damaged our reputation in the region and internationally. Any short-term political gain that our government has got from this policy is vastly outweighed by the damage it's done to our influence in the region, particularly over Papua New Guinea. So we therefore enter the next year facing a dilemma in respect of Papua New Guinea and the Pacific Islands. We have vital strategic interests in the region, but we have comparatively less influence with which to pursue them. Pacific Island states are increasingly unwilling to accept Australian leadership, and although they're a lot smaller than us and have a lot fewer material resources, they're able to exercise weapons of the weak. They're able to engage in foot dragging on agreements, they can expel our officials, stage demonstrations, they can sabotage agreements, and they can engage in brinkmanship in order to limit our influence. So Australia's influence in the Pacific Islands appears to defy conventional predictions, which would predict on a basic equation of size, relative material size, that we would be the hegemon. To the extent that we can be characterised as a hegemon in the region, we are an extremely hollow one.
Thanks, Michael. Good morning, everyone. It's a genuine pleasure to have the opportunity to address you all this morning on the vast topic of Southeast Asian affairs. I'd like to begin by making a special acknowledgement of our friends from the Westpac Bicentennial Foundation, and particularly all of the Westpac scholars who've joined us today. Many of you won't be aware that I have the great privilege of sitting on the national selection panel for the Westpac Scholarship Program, which means that I get to work closely with the Westpac team. It also means that I see the very high caliber of their applicant pool. What that means in practice is that the Westpac scholars who are here are of an outrageously high quality. They are a superb group of young Australians, and I'd really encourage everybody in the room to seek out some of the young guns who are in our presence. They're here to do what they can to soak up some of what the Coral Bell School has to offer, and we're simply delighted that you've been able to come with us on this journey today. So, Southeast Asia, 630 some million people, literally hundreds of languages, some scores of which are very significant languages, are often spoken by tens of millions of people. 10 countries in the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Let's rattle them off so that we appreciate the scope. We're talking from Vietnam to Laos, Cambodia, Thailand, Myanmar, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, the Philippines, and Brunei. Okay. That's a lot of the world. That is a lot of the world's action, and it's my task to distill it in a few quick minutes to give you a bit of a sense of where I see Southeast Asia heading this year and in the years to come. It has been suggested by some smart folks who do this kind of economic analysis that by the year 2020, some 400 million of those 600 million plus Southeast Asians will be classified as middle class. What that means is that they will have access to discretionary daily spending somewhere between $16 and $100. This means that Southeast Asia has changed from the kind of backwater economies that many people still have in mind. Southeast Asia is globally engaged and enmeshed, and the fact that it's right on Australia's doorstep suggests, to me at least, that we all need to be taking it incredibly seriously. It's impossible, no doubt, to speak of a single Southeast Asia, and just a quick show of hands, perhaps, who here has been to Singapore? Okay, all right, almost everybody in the room, okay? I think we should take that as an indication of Australian connection with our Southeast Asian neighbours. Many of you will have walked around Clark Quay, you know, the posh neighbourhood, lots of good restaurants, seafood, chili crab, all that action. It is tailor-made Singaporean perfection. I would suggest that Clark Quay is one of the bookends of the Southeast Asian region, right? And at the other end, okay, you've got very, very different sorts of places with very, very different sorts of economies and societies and priorities. I would put the Chin Hills in Myanmar as the other bookend. So from Clark Quay to the Chin Hills. Hands up if you've been to the Chin Hills. Okay, you should. And the reason you should is because Southeast Asia is a lot more than the bright lights, the big cities, the pulsating action that tends to get our attention in places like Bangkok and Kuala Lumpur and Manila and, of course, Singapore. There's so much more going on that we need to be getting to grips with if Australia is going to have a chance of prospering deep into the Asian century. That kind of variation is hard to keep in our heads at the same time. It really is the variation from Canberra to the Congo, right? And when you consider that ASEAN has the tasking to try and pull all of these different peoples and societies together, you can appreciate that that's never going to be straightforward. And the compromise that those who run the Association of Southeast Asian Nations have made over the generations is to avoid getting down into the nitty-gritty of each country's domestic political affairs. And of course, there's a very well understood doctrine of non-interference. What this tends to mean is that the countries of ASEAN don't go poking around in each other's backyards. But, of course, there is a huge amount of interest when things start to go wrong. And I just want to give you quickly three of the current areas where we have major changes in trajectory in Southeast Asia. And I think these three should suggest to us at least that a lot of what we currently grapple with isn't set in stone and could certainly, in the years and decades to come, be shaken up in some quite profound ways. So the first of these key changes relates, of course, to Myanmar. And in the past year, there is no bigger political story in Southeast Asia. I'd suggest perhaps almost no bigger political story in the world than the consolidation, albeit tentative, of Myanmar's democratic process. We know that last year, on the 8th of November, Aung San Suu Kyi's National League for Democracy triumphed at a long-awaited election. Nobody was quite sure at the time whether she and her team would be allowed to take power, but it turns out that a relatively smooth handover has been possible. Of course, the Myanmar armed forces are there, lurking in the background, waiting to strike if they perceive that their core interests are imperiled. But in the meantime, Aung San Suu Kyi has written herself a new job. She is the state councillor. This, in her words, means that she is above the president. That suggests to me, at least, that it is game on now for Myanmar very rapidly going from being one of the least democratic societies in the region and therefore on earth to being perhaps one of the great success stories. And we will have to watch very closely to see how the National League for Democracy handles these new challenges. Those challenges, secondly, are brought into a quite stark relief when you look at what has happened to Thailand. And a lot of the analytical effort over the past decade has focused on Bangkok-based squabbling. And that's important. There's absolutely no doubt that we need to be keeping our eyes on what's going on between the generals and deposed former Prime Minister Thaksin Shinawat and his lieutenants. We also need to be paying attention to various of the palace's politics, of course, because His Majesty King Bhumibol Adulyadej is now very old and unlikely to see out all that many more years on the throne. The fact that he's been on the throne since 1946, of course, means that the Thais are anxious. You can understand that, about what might happen next. But the big issue in Thailand, for me at least, isn't about that. It's about the festering civil conflict in the southernmost provinces down along the border with Malaysia. For a long time, that conflict was relatively contained. It looks, based on events in recent weeks, that the conflict is no longer so contained. That has grave implications. Everybody needs to be paying attention to what might happen if Thailand's hot southern insurgency starts to reach out and grab people in other places. Thirdly, and quickly, and finally, there's Malaysia. And Malaysia has been run more or less by the same crew since independence. That gives the state structure a certain resilience. Yet, right now, things are going to move and perhaps move quite quickly. Prime Minister Najib Razak, he's under pressure because of a corruption scandal. You all know about Southeast Asian corruption scandals. They come, they go. But this one is big, potentially $1 billion or more, it is alleged, have moved from some pockets to some other pockets in ways that can't quite be properly explained. That is going to take a lot of work on the part of Malaysia's government to handle. And this past weekend, students on the streets of Kuala Lumpur are showing their displeasure. This is the kind of situation that could pretty quickly escalate. And again, that would have implications for us all. So, in this context, what's Australia going to do with our Southeast Asian friends? We all appreciate the Southeast Asia of Clark Key. More of us need to be getting out to the Southeast Asia of the Chin Hills. Right now, there isn't a country within the region that I would suggest is Australia's BFF, right? We have close relationships, but do we absolutely have a best friend? We probably don't. In the future, we might really want to have one. That best friend should be democratic and outward-looking and well-positioned to take advantage of all the opportunities of the Asian century. I'd suggest if we're in the market for a best friend, then we should look very directly to Aung San Suu Kyi and her Myanmar as they go about this historic transformation. Thank you.
Thanks, Nick.
Well,
Well, thank you. Good to be with you again this morning. So I'm going to speak about China and Japan, the two countries that I know best and that we can try and cover in about 5 minutes, but very happy in the Q&A if people have questions about Korea or Taiwan to have a chat about those two. What I wanted to do in the next 5 minutes is paint a little bit of a picture of Australia's relationship with China and Japan over the last 12 months. Because we've seen, I think, some interesting contradictory impulses in those two relationships. So first, let's look at the Chinese side. In December of last year, Trade Minister Andrew Robb received an early Christmas present when CHAFTA, the China-Australia Free Trade Agreement, entered into force. This came out after nearly 10 years of negotiations by the various sides of government. It's a major trade agreement, a historic agreement, as Andrew Robb said at the time, between a country of 1.4 billion people, and Australia, and an enormous amount of opportunities for the rising middle class in China to purchase Australian services in particular. A couple of months later, fast forward to February 2016, Australia issues its defence white paper, in which we very prominently spoke about our concerns about the scale and pace of Chinese land reclamation activities in the South China Sea, and spoke in a number of places about, as Michael has said this morning, our concerns about the stability of the rules-based order, both in our region and at the global level, and paid particular concern to China in that defence white paper. The next month, it was perhaps not a surprise then to see concerns raised about a Chinese company investing in the Darwin port, at least a Chinese company in the Darwin port. And following that, the Australian government's decision to knock back investments into Kidman & Co. And most recently to the Ausgrid infrastructure investment in New South Wales. And in fact, just this weekend, I note that Prime Minister Turnbull, in referring to Australia's decision on Ausgrid, paraphrased, interestingly, Chairman Mao Zedong in saying, "I'll i.e. the Australian people have stood up, paraphrasing, you know, Mao Zedong's quote back in October 1949 when he said that the Chinese people had thrown off the shackles of foreign oppression and colonialism and were going to stand up for the principle of sovereignty. This is what Malcolm Turnbull was referring to when he spoke about Australia's national interest concerns with respect to the Ausgrid decision. And then just last month in July, the foreign minister with her counterparts from the United States and Japan during their trilateral strategic dialogue meeting in Laos came together and put out a joint statement in response to the arbitration decision in the South China Sea and took a position that was somewhat more fulsome than other countries have taken by sort of making the statement that the decision in the arbitration ruling was legally binding and that therefore China needed to abide by that legally binding decision. So some fits and starts, I think, in the Australia-China relationship over the last 12 months. The same, I think, can be said of the Australia-Japan relationship. 1 year ago, Tony Abbott was still in power. This is someone, to quote Nick for a minute, had described Japan as Australia's BFF in Asia, describing Japan as a potential ally, as Australia's best friend, and someone who very much saw the evolution and strategic development of a closer Australia-Japan security relationship as being in Australia's national interests. He had signed the Japan-Australia Economic Partnership Agreement. It looked possible, and I think even quite likely, that had Abbott remained in power, Japanese submarine decision may have come to the fore, particularly because a number of Abbott's key advisors were very much in favour of Japan winning that bid. Of course, the government changed, and what I think we saw of note in the defence white paper that came out in February was, although Australia and Japan moving closer together in terms of their security relationship, Japan was not singled out as a country for Australia to have an important strategic partnership with. Where Japan was referred to in the defence white paper, it was always, along with a long list of other countries, Korea, Indonesia, India, and others, with whom Australia had close security partnerships with. So a sense of, yes, we have moved closer in our relationship with Japan, we've signed a number of high-level agreements, but we're not willing to go out there and elevate Japan to a strategic partnership. In April, of course, Japan lost the submarine bid, and a decision that I think was actually ultimately taken for technical, for operational, for budgetary reasons, but a decision that was interpreted very much in Japan and here in Australia as a view that Japan and Australia perhaps did not share the same fate in terms of security. In the sort of the couple of years leading up to the bidding for that process, we'd seen the Japanese government and increasingly private firms, Mitsubishi and others in Japan, talking very much about the submarines deal being a proxy for the strategic partnership between our two countries. So, of course, when the bid did not go their way, that was the way in which it was interpreted. So, fits and starts in both of these two relationships, these key relationships for Australia, our two most important economic partners. And I think what this signifies is Australia's difficulty in muddling through relations with these two countries who have fundamentally different visions about what they want the future of Asia's strategic order to look like. Japan wants to lock in the strategic order that was created after World War II, with the United States as the primary power in Asia, and all of the other powers sort of underneath that, but with a small caveat. It wants Japan to play a more active strategic role in the region, to escape the post-World War II constitution that put Japan in a very abnormal role, but fundamentally to leave the regional order with the US as primary power. China wants to change that regional strategic order. It wants a more equal role with the United States. Some in China perhaps even advocate a primary role for China. I think that's a discussion that is still evolving within China, but certainly more strategic space for China. Historically, Australia has been able to manage our relationship with China and Japan on parallel tracks. They didn't really interact with one another. Things that we did in one relationship didn't really have a major impact on the relationship with the other. That is no longer possible because the relationship between these two great powers is now at a very thorny, contested, difficult point, economically incredibly important to Australia, but one in which both sides are watching how countries like Australia and others in Southeast Asia and the United States navigate those bilateral relationships. So we are at this sort of moment, I think, of fundamental transition. And I think looking at the year ahead, how will Australia try to manage these things? I think we'll obviously be trying to keep our good relationship with both states going forward. My sense is that the Australian government recognises that the Asian order is changing. I think that is language that came through in the Defence White Paper very strongly. And so on this, I think we actually may be closer to China than to Japan in being willing to recognise that the regional order is changing. But I think, like Japan, we are deeply uncomfortable with where that is going. First and foremost, because we're uncertain about what China will look like and how China will behave in that future strategic order. These questions are all up for debate within China, and I'm very happy to discuss some specifics of that in the Q&A if people have questions. But two areas I'd mention in particular. The first on the South China Sea. I think it's very interesting to note that a week after the arbitration decision came down, an important article by the Central Party School out of Beijing was fundamentally re-discussing, reopening the debate about what the nine-dash line actually means, how it's defined, what it relates to. This is a question that is not entrenched within China. It is evolving, and it's something that I think Australia and others would do well to pay very, very close attention to. And secondly, on sort of the economic questions, the infrastructure questions, things that Michael raised this morning, for example, about the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, this is a space where Australia can actually work with China to help evolve kind of the norms and questions and governance around how these sorts of things operate. It's something that Australia and China are already talking about, for example, through the Australia-China Joint Economic Report, which came out last fortnight. And so I think there is actually great scope for Australia to play a role in this area. Finally, I think on the relationship with Japan, this is a relationship that needs to be managed. It will be a bellwether for how Australia views the regional strategic order going forward. But the challenge for Australia is how to pursue a closer relationship with Japan that perhaps does not sign on to completely the view of the region that the Japanese government currently has. Thank you.
Bina.
Thanks, Michael. Well, I want to ask, how many of you watch cricket? There you go. That's Australia's relationship with South Asia. Australia...
Not going very well.
Not going very well, actually. Australia plays cricket with five of the South Asian countries, which are India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Afghanistan. And then there are three other countries which are also part of this region, which are Bhutan, the Maldives, and Nepal. They play cricket within the region, but not necessarily so active in the international cricket scene. So Australia's relationship in South Asia is incredibly important, particularly because Australia has a very strong connection with one of the key regional and international players, India. But there's also a relationship is also strengthening with other South Asian countries. Now, this is the region where at the moment world's largest number of people living below the poverty line, which is actually at the moment 507 million people, they live here with less than US$1.25 per day. So extreme poverty is one of the key issues that the region tackles with. There's large and uneven differences exist that across populations within the region's countries, including in areas of health, education, status of women, and employment and education status of young people. So development gains, which continue to be offset by population growth, rapid urbanization is widespread. And with that also we see various kinds of inequality and human rights violations. But there's also massive infrastructure deficits, particularly in energy and transport sector. And these are also binding constraints on growth. South Asia is also the world's least integrated region in terms of actually trade and economic connectivity. So what Australia had done is actually in Australia's focus, what we often see is that Australia looks at the region's two most important long-term transboundary development issues. The first one is sustainable development issues through water, food, and energy security. And the second one is regional connectivity. So Australia promotes that through trade facilitation and infrastructure connectivity. If you look at Australian official documents, you'll see that over the last 5 years, we've also seen a significant focus in both of these areas on gender equality and human rights issues. So Australia is really keen to actually promote and work in those areas. And that is often done not through government-to-government connection, but actually through civil society and civil society connection. So this people-to-people emphasis is incredibly important. And one area where Australia had done very well in terms of the region is education sector. So Australia is one of the most important providers of education of South Asians, not only in other parts of different sectors, but also in the government. So that's where Australia had provided a lot of expertise in the region. So if we go through country by country, I'll just pick up a few issues which are important. The first one is obviously India. So Australia has placed India at the forefront of its international partnerships. Now, the two-way trade of goods is incredibly important. In 2014-15, it was 18 billion. And both governments also recognize that there is significant potential for further cooperation across a broad range of areas. So there had been a lot of high-level meetings, the last one in November 2015 in Turkey during the G20 summit when prime ministers of both countries met and talked about their strategic partnership. So that partnership had also been developed and agreed on in 2009. So Australia and India's relationship is based on, at least the formal relationship, is based on that strategic partnership. Now, Australia's relationship with India goes back a long way, even prior to India's independence. So the first Indian consulate was established in Sydney in 1941. So why it's incredibly important is that there are lots of Indian migrants who live here. So if you look at last year's statistics, we know that 450,000 people of Indian descent, they now live in Australia. And India is Australia's largest source of skilled migrants and also the second largest source of international students, which last year was more than 60,000. That's 2015 data I'm providing you with. Now, You would also remember a few years ago there were lots of attacks in Melbourne and Sydney on Indian students. So in Indian media, what had happened is that Australia's it was portrayed that Australia is somehow racist, and the India-Australia cricket competition didn't help much in that kind of media discourse. So there's a lot of actually confidence building that had to happen in that area, but we've seen high-level actually visits from both sides, particularly from the education ministries and the education sector, and in science and technology sector, there's very interesting and important collaboration that's happening. So those are some of the areas where actually different kind of partnership could be built and confidence building measures. The second country is Bangladesh in South Asia, which is the second important trade partner of South Asia for Australia. So last year, the trade relationship between Bangladesh and Australia was more $2.7 billion. So it's increasing, so Australia is also recognizing it as an important partner, but Australia is also aware of some of the issues, for example, in the garment sector in Bangladesh, and also in the growing inequality in the labor market. So Australia does provide a lot of actually advice and training to the industry partners in Bangladesh. And in terms of Australia's other relationship with Bangladesh is actually the counter-terrorism cooperation area. So Bangladesh signed its first memorandum of agreement with Australia in combating terrorism in 2008. And after that, last year, we've seen some counter-terrorism training, joint training exercises that took place both in Australia and in Bangladesh. So there's interesting and important kind of collaboration happening within the security sector. Pakistan, Australian government had actually intensified its security relationship, security and strategic relationships since 2008, not before that, because there were different phases of looking at the international war and how that was actually also integrating Australia's roles and relationship within in Pakistan. But from 2008, the new relationship looks at economic reform, security sector reform, and also democratic governance. So it's interesting and important area for Pakistan and Australia. But what we've seen also from Pakistani civil society and also from the education sector is that there's a lot of complaints about that how limited number of Pakistani students, for example, are accepted in Australian institutions. For example, in 2014, only 58 Pakistani students were given scholarships in Australian universities. In 2015, the number was even less. But what we see is that some of the scholarship to Pakistani, the members of the Pakistani armed forces and the police is increasing. For example, in 2014, Australia provided places for up to 120 members of Pakistani armed forces. So interesting and important kind of area, but there's a lot to do in terms of how actually universities could reach out to Pakistani students in different way. One area where Australian government had been incredibly concerned with, and it had raised it in Human Rights Council and also in the Asia Pacific Human Rights Forum, is Pakistan's human rights record. After the 2014 December school attack in Peshawar, what happened is that Pakistan lifted the moratorium on death penalty. And as you know, Australia is incredibly committed in death penalty advocacy. So it had been working with Pakistani civil society groups and also Pakistani Human Rights Commission in that area. Sri Lanka is the other important country of South Asia, with whom Australia has very important connections in terms of people smuggling areas. For in 2014, Australia provided with two vessels for Sri Lankan Navy to the Bay-class vessels to the Sri Lankan Navy to work in the Indian Ocean region for surveillance. Now, what had happened after that is that from the Sri Lankan civil society sector, there was a lot of actually anger and anxiety about why Australian government is connecting with the Sri Lankan government in some of those traditional security issues. So while we see that with the government, with the Sri Lankan government and Australian government, there is significant partnership developing, it's almost in many ways absent with people-to-people partnership, especially after the war ended in May 2009. And Australia also did not co-sponsor the May 2014 resolution, UN resolution, which was looking at the war crimes issues in Sri Lanka. But Australia did co-sponsor last year in September, 2015 resolution. So there is some change in the relationship, but there's a long way to go. The last country here I would like to talk about is Afghanistan. And many of you would be very much aware of that that relationship is not only incredibly important, but that relationship is also actually changing, particularly after January 2015, when we saw that there was a handover of security responsibility from the NATO-led ISAF to the government of Afghanistan. So what we now have, actually, the statistics, is that currently, there are 270 Australian defence personnel who are working in the Resolute Support Mission in Afghanistan, which are actually supporting the Australian Afghanistan security sector in various training programs and also in other areas of looking at provincial security. So there's really interesting and important connections and collaborations happening in different sectors between Australia and South Asia, but there's a long way to go in terms of working on human rights dialogues and human rights conversations within the region and internationally, and also actually various kinds of strategic collaboration. Thank you.
Trump. I think I could probably spend a good 7 minutes talking about Donald Trump, and I'm sure he'd spend plenty of time talking about Donald Trump in question and answer as well. But what I want to do a little bit is talk about a bit of policy and practice in the US-Australian relationship over the last 12 months or so. And I think this is important because I want to follow on from the first panel this morning, because we are in this era, I think, of uncertainty. And I think this puts us in Australia strategically in the region and in the United States as well, in the same position of being in a certain level of sort of strategic grey zone about what's happening, given that we're both feeling our way, both the United States and Australia, in a region that's seeing unprecedented historic and strategic change. And in terms of policy, to talk about that, I think I refer you back to the Defence White Paper, which Amy also mentioned, that came out earlier this year. If you actually go through and pick out all the sections that talk about the US-Australian relationship, it's interesting that despite we've got a very, very close strategic partnership going on for a very long period of time, that it was actually managed to ramp this up even more in the language that the white paper was using. And as one particular commentator spoke about, this, the white paper was about turbocharging, was the quote of the US-Australian relationship. Obviously, from the White Paper's point of view, the incredibly important relationship we have around the Five Eyes intelligence relationship, which gets deeper and broader every year. Also around foreign military sales, we're one of the greatest beneficiaries of US foreign military sales. And this technology access, particularly fifth generation military technology, really underpins a lot of our defence posture and our defence partnerships. Particularly here, access to Growler electronic warfare aircraft, which were the only US ally to get access to that technology so far. Our partnership along with the United States and many other allies with the F-35, which is, I believe we've got our first, now second actually aircraft that we actually own, and our RAAF personnel over training on that. Of course, an expansion into discussions around more on cyber cooperation, and of course, missile defence. And of course, on another policy perspective, earlier on, following on with the trade deals with China and other areas in Japan, we're also signed up to the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the TPP. So these are some pretty big, significant policy announcements. And I think the white paper was very clear in its signal about where it sees Australia and the relationship going forward from the strategic perspective into the future. However, this is offset by a few things that have happened over in the last 12 months. And as Amy mentioned earlier, Of course, one of the first things was the controversy surrounding the sale of Darwin Port to a Chinese company. If people can remember back to the commentary that was around that, there was a lot of commentators who were very concerned about this. There was also some polling done by the US Embassy around what they thought about that, and of course some material that was sort of leaked or discussed with journalists that came out about how very much unhappy the United States were about this relationship. Concerns that they hadn't been forewarned about this was particularly happening, and of course concerned about where this was going. In fact, one US commentator referred to it as being stunned by Australia's decision and the approach that was made there. And this, of course, created a fair bit of debate in Australia between some people like Peter Jennings and Jeff Wade, who are very opposed to this particular position, and then others like Linda Jacobson and James Brown, who was trying to put this in more perspective about the way the relationship has to work between our major alliance partner and our major trading partner. Following on from a little bit about this, we see, of course, Malcolm Turnbull had been elected, and we see Turnbull's first visit to the United States, and his speech at CSIS in particular on the 18th of January earlier this year. And it's a really important speech, I think, in that it started to slightly recalibrate the way Australia political class starts to think about the relationship. If you think about the sort of rhetoric that Julia Gillard had when she was in the US, and of course then followed by the rhetoric and the sort of approach that Tony Abbott has. And of course it was in the media, this famous event where Tony Abbott goes in and meets Barack Obama and basically says, you know, everyone comes into this room to ask for things, I'm here to just offer unqualified support, what do you need us to do? And it was sort of this sense of that was getting into this point of a sort of an unquestionable relationship with the United States, where Turnbull put a little bit more nuance, I would say, back into this relationship. And what Alan Gingell in particular pointed out was the absence of absolutes in Turnbull's speech there when he was in Washington. He pressured the US to ratify UNCLOS. He also talked about a possible two-state solution in Syria and Iraq and a state for the Sunnis in Iraq. And that was entering in a little bit of advocacy into the speeches that we had not seen in previous visits by Australian prime ministers. Also, Amy mentioned the submarine decision. That's an important piece, I think, in the broader relationship. Of course, there was great criticism from a lot of people. Some people seeing it as a loss of opportunity to broaden the relationship between the United States, Japan, and Australia, and particularly this hub-to-hubs collaboration in the San Francisco system and network, which one US commentator, Mike Green, had called the Australia-Japan relationship a sort of poster child for this hub-to-hub relationship. And I certainly agree with Amy here that it seems to be a recalibration of where that's going. Certainly the Japanese interpreted this as a proxy for what would be a particular type of strategic relationship along with Australia and the United States. And that was very much cast, as we know, as an Abbott thing, an Abbott-Abe deal. The handshake agreements, the meetings that they'd had, and of course the special relationship that was developing out of there, and Abbott's, of course, best friend in Asia comment as well. Another interesting thing, though, if you look into some of the detail of the white paper, was some of the language has started to change about the Marine Rotational Deployment Force to Darwin as well. And basically, there was a pushing out of the MRFD relationship by a couple of years. So the timetable of that is not progressing as fast as it was a few years ago and of what the rhetoric was originally when it came about. And of course, this has all come down to another issue in the relationship, which is about the cost of the infrastructure in Darwin and the negotiations between Australia and the United States over that infrastructure development. So this is $2 billion worth of investment in terms of runways and barracks, which has basically been described by some as stalled in that particular relationship, and how this has led to a feeling of mutual annoyance between Australia and the United States over these issues. And of course, then that raises the question, is there any correlation between the Darwin port sale and the Darwin infrastructure development and issues? I think mainly this is hard bargaining and good hard bargaining. We are friends and partners, but when it comes to spending money, you get down and bargain hard. And of course, the US like to approach a sort of cookie cutter approach to all their relationships, and Australia doesn't like that. We negotiated a different relationship with our intelligence facilities, and I think we're pushing a very sort of slightly different relationship to many of the other US allies in the region and around the world in terms of that infrastructure and development. Adding to this, other instrument, as mentioned, we signed up to the TPP, which is incredibly important. Turnbull particularly reiterated in his speech in Washington the importance of the TPP for the future economic relationship in the region, and encouraging that, because what we do know is there's some concern and resistance in the US Congress to this, and particularly what I'll get to in a minute, we have both presidential candidates at the moment who are opposed to the TPP in either its current form or opposed to the TPP full stop. And that's an interesting development for where it's going with the United States. There's been some recent research also come out from our colleagues at the Crawford School talking about the US-Australia Free Trade Agreement, and particularly talking about how it's actually not been that beneficial to either side. In fact, I think the figure was, and Amy knows this better than me, I think it was $53 billion in investment from either side that could have possibly been better invested elsewhere, particularly in the Asia-Pacific region. So there's a little bit of fits and starts going on here as well. If you go back a couple of years ago, there was, with the Marine Rotational Force deployment in Darwin, there was also great talk about HMAS Stirling. There's also great talk about the Cocos Islands and great talk about expansion in those other areas. And while I don't think we're seeing any fundamental change, there's been a cooling off in some of this rhetoric and a cooling off in some of this particular direction. And this mainly comes down to what we're seeing happening in the United States. And I think this is fundamentally key to what happens to the US and to the region and what happens with our relationship in the United States. Because what we're seeing in the US is a complete fracturing of the US foreign policy consensus that has been in existence since the end of the Second World War. There was close bipartisan consensus for a very long period of time from the centre-left and centre-right about a global forward presence of the US in the world. And that is fundamentally gone. It certainly hangs on in the commentariat. It's certainly strong in areas of the bureaucracy and certainly some areas of the political class. But we're seeing it attacked by both the left and the right in US politics. On the right, of course, we're seeing the advocates of the Tea Party, the libertarian movements, and others which have fundamentally come out and rejected the sort of forward interventionist approach to the world. There's isolationists amongst them. There are all types of different approaches which has fractured the very great strength that has been the Republican view of foreign policy for that very long period of time. And of course now on the other side of politics, we've seen through the Bernie Sanders phenomenon also a rejection of free trade, of the forward presence and those types of issues on the left of US politics as well. So going into this particular election period, we're seeing a very different approach, a fracturing of that broad-based consensus about what the US's approach to the world is. This means a broad questioning of what the US's global role will be. It leads to an ambiguous strategic global posture for the United States into the future. It raises questions about the future of the TPP, not just in Congress, but within who might be the President of the United States. And when you get to the Trump phenomenon, it's fascinating. I mean, he's come out with an America first view of the world, an America first view of foreign policy. Now, to me, this is part deal making, and Trump is a great deal maker. Who's not to say that a Trump in power wouldn't cut a deal with China, with Russia, with any other country in the world if he feels it is in his particular interest? So it's part deal making, it's part narcissism, it's part populism, it's part isolationist, it's a part defensive realist, and it's a part interventionist, which means it's completely schizophrenic. And he has advocated all those different positions along the same way, and if Trump does get into power, his power base is an inherent form of particular populism amongst the US democratic, US democracy. So he's going to feed that particular political base back in the United States, and he's going to feed that in a particular way that is really unsure about where it goes into the future. Now, if you look at all the polls, and I read them very often, it's going in the way that Hillary Clinton looks more and more certain every day. But let's face it, how many of us in the room wrote Donald Trump off in the primaries? Right? Probably a lot of people. I certainly did. Okay, let's not yet write him off in the presidential election. But even if Hillary does win, we're going to see a different version of US foreign policy going. I think a different version of what Hillary would have liked to put forward even 12 months ago. She's had to walk back on the TPP because of her own left wing of her own party and her own base. She's going to be hamstrung not just by Congress, but a fracturing of her own party and a fracturing, particularly the Republicans, which she would need to rely upon for some of the broad-based consensus on foreign policy that we've seen in past years. So this puts us into a really fascinating era. If you read the defense white paper, we're all hitched to the United States and it's gonna get deeper and stronger. It starts in the minister's introduction, the phrase deeper and stronger, and it's littered all the way through the defense white paper. But if you look at what's happening politically in the United States and we look at what's happening in the region, we're in a very big, I think, unknown zone and grey zone that will affect the way that our relationship with the United States, and particularly the way the United States' relationship with our region goes forward into the future.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, five incredibly rich presentations. It's now your turn to engage with our speakers. While you're thinking of questions and comments, I'm going to ask each of our panellists to nominate for the new Australian foreign policy white paper what element of Australia's policy towards your particular region or relationship would you change and why? Not necessarily. Does anyone else want to jump in first?
Oh, look, I can go.
Okay.
I think, in reference, I talked about the negotiations and the PACER Plus trade agreement, and this real sticking point there is labour mobility, which is a very important issue for the Pacific Islands. They have very young populations, and they're not very few economic opportunities and job opportunities for them. And, you know, a young unemployed population can become a constituency that can be involved in violence and crime. So having an outlet in Australia would be very beneficial for them. We already have a seasonal worker scheme that's quite limited in its scope, although we have removed the cap on the number of participants. But I think I would invite the Australian government to think more about labour mobility and more opening up to our Pacific neighbours on that issue.
Thanks, Michael. From my perspective, most of what's going to, I'd expect, be in this new DFAT white paper related to Southeast Asia will be very good, very prudent, very appropriate. It's based on a huge amount of Australian investment in doing Southeast Asia right, and certainly there is a huge amount that those who've been actively involved should be proud of. One area where clearly Australia needs to do better is in terms of how it is that we support, assist and partner with our Southeast Asian nations to handle the irregular migration flows that they all deal with on a day-to-day, week-to-week basis. Malaysia, just as one example, has a couple of million people who we would consider to be illegal migrants by our terms, who are working in Malaysia, doing, of course, a great many of the jobs that Malaysians themselves no longer want to do. But when there is so much carry-on in the Australian body politic about relatively small numbers of people seeking to get to our shores, of course, we don't get a whole lot of sympathy from decision makers in Putrajaya and elsewhere. Australia is going to need to work with a region where borders are much less important than they've tended to be in the recent past. Our border between Southeast Asia and Australia is going to need to be reconsidered at some stage. That's politically impossible right now, but deep into this century, when Southeast Asia is a much richer place, we will want to have sophisticated ties, and those are going to require some very liberal movements of people.
The thing I would put into the Defence White Paper, Foreign Affairs White Paper, is for Australia and Japan to spearhead the initiative to link up TPP and RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. RCEP doesn't currently include the United States, TPP doesn't currently include China. It is absolutely in our interest to make sure that the region's economic agreements don't divide down a China and US-led line. Australia and Japan are party to both of these agreements. It would be a nice way of celebrating the work that Australia and Japan did together back in the late 80s and early 90s in fostering the principle of open regionalism and working together in our joint economic interests to hold Asia together.
So Australia talks about this deeper and broader engagement in terms of closer educational, cultural, and people-to-people ties in South Asia. So in terms of that, I would like to have more focus, for example, on civil society relationship between Australia and not only in terms of government to government, but actually civil society partnerships, strengthening that. The main reason for that is actually that South Asian governments and South Asian people, this inherent distrust in many ways, decades of, there's a historical reason, the way actually regimes have actually run the different countries because of weak governance system, this inherent distrust of people of South Asia and how they think their government actually represents their interest with other important states of the world, and particularly a middle power state like Australia. So this is an area, and Australia and Sri Lanka, for example, had all these different kinds of irregular migration agreements happening. Australia and Pakistan had those, and Australia and Afghanistan. So in some of those areas, just focusing on what Joanne talked about and Nick mentioned, I think irregular migration in that area and in the human rights area, I think there's a lot of important connections to be made. So that's what I would like to have a little bit of focus on.
I suppose one issue, one region. I mean, more broadly, I think it's wise to remember, I mean, I spoke a little bit about, obviously, the discord in the US foreign policy, but I think it's wise to remember that the United States does have 50 allies around the world. That accounts for 75% of global trade and 70% of our military spending. And it is still the preeminent military power in our region and a really dominant economic power. And I agree with Amy here. We have to get the United States more engaged in bringing TPP and RCEP together. You know, Obama's spoken recently in terms of TPP as sort of a strategic bloc against China. You know, that's not in our interest, and I don't think it's in the United States' interest either. And so we've got to work more, and we can see the issues we've seen, I mentioned around the US-Australia Free Trade Agreement, more about trade liberalisation, and that's going to be difficult for the United States given the way Congress sits and particularly the way Trump and Bernie Sanders have spoken, but we've really got to push that issue. And I think that's fundamentally important. The one region I want to focus on is Nick's region, Southeast Asia. We have to do more in Southeast Asia. We want the US to do more. The pivot rebalance was supposed to be all about Southeast Asia, and it's lost a bit of its gloss and it's a bit of its shine. But most importantly, we've got to get the US to stop asking us to do more in the Middle East and get the US to start asking us to do more in Southeast Asia. And we've got to make that clear. That's both in their interest and in our interest. It's, you know, they've got plenty of other partners in the Middle East. If they really need us, it's a value add for the US for us to do more in Southeast Asia, and it's a value add for us to do it. So if we can really push this notion of, you know, stop asking us to do things in the Middle East, start asking us to do more in Southeast Asia, because it's hard to say no sometimes to such a big global power, and it's hard to say no when you've got such a deep relationship. But I firmly believe the long-term interest of both countries is in the Indo-Pacific or Asia-Pacific region, and where we can value add to that is the South Pacific, where we already do a lot, and the Americans expect us to look after that area, and we need to manage that well, but particularly Southeast Asia, where a lot of our interests coincide. And, you know, we have far less weight and influence in Northeast Asia than we do in Southeast Asia.
Okay, thank you. Okay, over to you, folks. Questions, comments? Yeah, please.
Good afternoon. My name's Robert Kidston. Before I put a question to the panel, in particular to Peter Dean, could I ask how many people have read the recently published book by Jane Mayer regarding US politics called Dark Money, only published a couple of weeks ago, and also the celebrated biographer Jean Edward Smith, who's written a biography recently published on George W. Bush. Show of hands. I've read them, they're quite large, or at least the Edwards Smith book is a large one, 832 pages. The Mayer book's a little lighter. But having read those and preceding the reading of those, reading the late Malcolm Fraser's book, Dangerous Allies, I'm wondering, Peter, get your observations on how risky is it for Australia to bind itself too closely to the United States, given the extraordinary level of governance dysfunction that's currently evident in the United States. The book by Mayer in particular, Ms. Mayer is a 60-year-old, multi-award winning investigative journalist for The New Yorker, who spent 5 years looking at the money trail within the United States, which has essentially brought about a hyper-partisan gridlock, which is inhibiting, indeed impeding, any sensible decision making within the United States government. Pretty well everything one reads these days suggests that this is becoming a major problem for the United States' allies, in particular Australia. So, Peter, I'm wondering if you could make some observations about how risky it is for us to bind ourselves uncritically, I think, to many of the United States' ventures internationally at the present time and in the future, irrespective of who wins the presidential elections.
So there's a lot in there. Thanks for that. I think, look, fundamentally, I mean, there are concerns about the US political system. There are concerns about our political system. There are concerns about a lot of democratic political systems around the world. I don't think the problems in the US are unique to the US. You know, we look at the makeup of our own Senate. Look at what's happening in some of the democratic regimes in Europe as well. And democracy and liberalism and stuff is facing some severe challenges. I think this goes back to what was discussed by Kieran Gilbert and the others in the panel this morning, that, you know, one of the responses of what's happening in the US is the fact that the working class hasn't had a real wage rise in about two decades, and many of the middle class are slipping back to the working class and the working class into the underclass. So when you're getting this disparity in wages growth and income, that creates some broad-based problems in a lot of democratic regimes around the world. In terms of Fraser's approach, I think he completely miscalculated what he was writing about in that book. He was projecting into the future a particular view of US foreign policy, a neoconservative view of US foreign policy that was prominent after September 11th, which we don't see anymore. And certainly the Obama doctrine is very different in its approach. It's an attempt to recalibrate that interventionist regime. The other thing when it comes to being an ally of the United States, we can say no. We've said no plenty of times to the United States in the past, and we've raised some particular questions and issues. If you go back in Asia and look at what happened around the Taiwan Straits crisis and a few things many decades ago, we were absolutely very forefront with the United States of saying, it's not in your best interest to do these things, it's not in our best interest to do this, and we won't support you. Just because we're aligned to the United States doesn't mean we have to agree with everything. And certainly if a Trump president does get elected, that would need to be the very strong, firm stance that we take, that if Trump's doing things that we don't agree with, we have to make that very loud and very clear. That doesn't aberrate the alliance or break the alliance. I think one of the concerns I have is a lack of sometimes being able to be critical of the alliance and look at it with a hard-edged nose. I mean, there's been some interesting comments by Richard Woolacott and a few other people in recent times, and I think it's all contributing to a very positive debate we need to have about the alliance. But I notice he and others have been attacked that any questioning the alliance basically means you're pro-China. You know, it seems to be this dichotomy split sometimes in our discussion of the US relationship, that you're either all in or you're completely opposed. There can be a happy middle ground, I think, in there, where we look at it from our own strategic interests, and it's been very strong in the past of doing that, and I think it can be, and I think we're seeing signs of that in the current political debate as well. I'm not sure if that answers your question directly, I suppose the other thing to think about is what are the strategic alternatives if we don't ally ourselves with the United States? Fraser was pointing out you go armed and independent. Armed and independent is going to cost you 2 to 3 times what we're paying in GDP. Is the Australian people willing to do that? And is that in our best strategic and foreign policy interest? Do we go the way of New Zealand? You know, do we backpedal from the alliance and backpedal and take basically the approach that the Greens Party is putting forward, which is unarmed and neutral into the region of the world? Or can we find another partner in Southeast Asia or Northeast Asia or somewhere else in the world to have another great and powerful friend with? So these are about strategic choices we have to make. I still think it's by far in our best interest to maintain our close relationship with the United States. We just have to manage that in a very pragmatic way going forward.
Okay.
And Terry Henderson, I was interested in the juxtaposition between Amy and Nicholas's presentations, particularly on the South China Sea. Now, Amy intimated that maybe things aren't all that frozenly browned in China. I'm glad to hear that Global Times doesn't have the last word on these things. And Nicholas talked about ASEAN, and about half the ASEAN countries have a direct involvement with the border on the direct China Sea, and the other half don't. Some of those that don't have direct borders with China, one of which was Myanmar, which Nicholas has intimated might become an Australian best friend. Is there How do you see ASEAN and China interacting on this over the next few years? And is there any role Australia can play other than sending or not sending ships in international waters?
I'll take it first, Tom. Yeah. I mean, I think you're right. The Global Times certainly doesn't have the last word on this, and they play a role in the Chinese debate, but by no means representative of official views all the time. I think Australia would actually do well to listen more to what our Southeast Asian neighbours are saying on this issue. They confront this issue much more palpably than we do. As you said, they border or share waters with China. And I think it's interesting that, you know, as Nick has said, Southeast Asia is not one voice. And they have always tried to negotiate between kind of the US and China on a whole range of issues. And there is a spectrum of views within ASEAN on this question. So I think we need to sort of educate ourselves as much as possible with that spectrum and see how that spectrum might be shifting. But don't demand that ASEAN come out one side or the other. I don't think that's a particularly helpful response necessarily. I think they have very sophisticated views on these questions, and very often in the Australian debate, you tend to get the sense that we think they're not strategic in their thinking or they are cowed by China. They have more influence than we give them credit for. They live with this issue much more palpably. We would do well to learn as much as possible about different Southeast Asian perspectives on this issue.
I think Amy's right that every country in Southeast Asia has so much at stake in its relationship with China, and that of course includes Vietnam and the Philippines, who are currently caught in this tug of war. That won't last forever, and they hope to come through this current phase of disquiet and some antagonism with ever strengthened relationships with the behemoth to their north. Who could blame them for seeking to defend their interests while also maintaining a great deal of what has been good about the regional political equation over the last generation or three? I think for Australia and Australians, we do, as Amy has advised, need to be aware of exactly how it is that an ASEAN consensus emerges. It tends to all go on behind closed doors. And so if Australia wants in the years ahead to be an influential voice, we need to make sure that wherever possible, we are also behind those closed doors. That's not going to be easy necessarily, given some of the perceptions of Australian meddling. When we fast forward the tape, though, to pick up the possibility of a different great and powerful friend, certainly for Australia, that is not going to be Myanmar. That country will never have the heft. A country like Indonesia will at some stage be a serious, not only regional, but global power. Australians will want to be on friendly terms with that global power unless we're prepared to go about much more significant investments in terms of our defence posture and a much more aggressive foreign policy. So then in 2050, say, if Indonesia's one of the world's maybe top three economies, we will want them to be working hand in glove with us. By that stage, we might only have 40 million people of our own. We will be tiny, insignificant. We will be begging them to take us on board. So what could we do right now, given that I've had an extra few minutes to reflect on Michael's suggestion of what could go in this new DFAT white paper? If you were going to be really bold, really assertive, really forward-thinking, you would, on behalf of the government, make a statement. Of course, at this stage, it would be merely a statement of intent that every single Australian school student learns Indonesian to a conversational standard. I would guess, I won't go the show of hands option, I would guess relatively few people in this room speak Indonesian to a conversational standard. We should.
I'm Michael Hall, one of the Westpac Future Leaders Scholars. I wonder if I can be a little greedy and actually ask two questions at once. Both very different topics, which I'm really interested in. One for Bina, which it might be a little bit hard to comment on considering it's all a bit uncertain at the moment, but I'm interested about how the Brexit will influence our relationship with South Asia, because there's a lot of, obviously, immigration from South Asia to UK, and the vote from Brexit indicates that there's a bit of, I think part of that Brexit campaign was around almost closing the borders down a little bit, which for me, if I was a South Asian, would sort of make me a bit cautious about wanting to head in that direction if I was going to be leaving the area. So I'm interested to know what you think about how that's going to affect our relationship. The other one was for Amy, wanting to, I guess, have a bit of an update on the current climate around North Korea in that sort of region.
Thanks, Michael, for the question. Very interesting question, and I think the discussions, as you know, that we're still having it in different ways. So prior to the referendum and afterwards, what we've seen from the Australian government is this whole discussion and this public kind of various comments that Brexit is not going to actually impact that seriously on Australia. But at the same time, when I was looking at Indian newspapers and the Sri Lankan and Bangladeshi Pakistani newspapers, we've seen that there's a lot of anxiety about what was going to happen to all these people who live, not only the labor migrants who live in the UK, but also actually educated migrant community who live in the UK. What's going to happen to them? So that is still there, as far as I understand. And soon after the referendum, what we've seen, the increasing cases of attacks against actually migrant communities there that affected East London, for example, where a lot of Indian community people, they live in that area. So we've seen that. And around the same time, we've also seen that some of the funding from the research grants of people who are working on issues of South Asia have been immediately cut down. I can give you examples of issues of environmental displacement programs, which were offered actually European funding prior to Brexit announcements, and the result. But even Article 50 wasn't activated. What we've seen is that they have been cut down. Various institutions in India have received letters saying that they're cutting down all those kind of funding. So the impact, we don't know yet how far it's going to be felt within the region. But we see of the migrant community which lives in the UK, there's a lot of anxiety. And because of that, we've also seen a little bit, maybe a slight increase of applications to migrations in different migration schemes in Australia, but I can't tell you in detail about that. These are also just newspaper reports, but Australia have also been traditionally quite conservative in terms of how many migrants it would take in educated migrants, skilled migrants from South Asia. So with all of that at the moment, I think it's actually quite vague. But you're right, you've mentioned it at the beginning, that there's a lot of questions and anxiety regarding Brexit.
On North Korea, first thing I'd say is the real expert on this is Brendan Taylor, who's sitting at the back of the room, so I'd suggest you chase him down in the lunch break to get his views on this as well. But yeah, I mean, the North Korean issue continues to be a problematic one, not least with the missile test just recently into waters very close to Japan. I think, interestingly, it's become an issue that actually might be uniting Korea, South Korea, Japan and China. Their foreign ministers met recently and made a joint statement, which is something that's often very hard for those three countries to do, so possibly an area for cooperation. But I think, fundamentally, you know, the platform that used to be used for dealing with this issue, the six-party talks, has broken down because of very different views about what the sort of underlying security question is. Is it about ridding the peninsula of nuclear weapons, which is sort of the US-Japanese view? Is it about North Korea's security and its view of the security of its regime? Is it about China's view about, you know, which powers get to play a role on the Korean peninsula close to its borders? And until we can sort of get some resolution on kind of what the fundamental core security issue is, North Korea will continue to be able to play off these powers in the way that it has done.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for those really interesting little snippets. So I'm an engineer, and I can sense here that there's a lot of excitement about the opportunities that more freer trade can offer. But in my industry, there's actually a lot of fear, because we're subject to really strict regulations and things about safety and environmental, and you know, wages, superannuation, all that sort of thing. And people are really frightened that the businesses they work for aren't going to be able to compete with imports where, rightly or wrongly, the regulations might not be so strict. So, I mean, I guess a really poignant example at the moment is the steel industry and the struggles that they're having. What would you say to someone who is, freaking out that their business isn't going to be sustainable with all of the free trade?
I mean, I think you're right. And I think we had this sort of first generation of free trade and opening up in the region that was just breaking down high tariff levels, and that was great. That achieved a lot. The much trickier part of freeing up trade is dealing with harmonisation of standards and things like this. And that's where particularly Southeast Asia, China, are at a different level with regards to some of the older players in the region, Japan, Australia, the United States. So I think it's very incumbent upon the Australian government to be working with, through things like RCEP, to try and harmonise some of those standards. Because as you say, without some sort of certainty, business is very unlikely to invest or do the sorts of things that you want to sort of achieve these opportunities that we've been talking about.
Anyone else want to?
Just quickly. So late last year, while most people were celebrating the Christmas New Year shutdown, the ASEAN 10 came together as the ASEAN Economic Community. Sounds very big and brash and important. In practice, though, it's still very underdone when it comes to all of these issues of harmonisation. And there's nobody within policy circles in Southeast Asia who seriously believes that in this coming generation we will get Clark Key and the Chin Hills harmonised to any extent. And that's the internal ASEAN conversation. It will be painstaking and frustrating and very difficult. Of course, people in Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, they have similar concerns about being flooded by cheap knockoffs or labour that will work for a fraction of the ordinary market rate. So that those sorts of issues are going to be handled across a region like Southeast Asia as well. So Australia needs to play it smart and ensure that we do what we possibly can to get everybody working well together while appreciating that that won't happen quickly or easily.
I'll just add one thing. I mean, think about it in terms of opportunities as well. I mean, you've got an amazing skills benefit. You're probably educated. Where did you do your engineering degree?
Brisbane, UQ.
One of the best leading universities in the country and in the world. That those are transferable skills domestically, nationally, regionally, and internationally as well. So, you know, you're thinking about, you're starting at an advantage compared to the people in those other countries, in a huge advantageous position. So think more broadly about that. Try and value add to that particular skills advantage you got, and do the best you can to drive that forward. And that may be working in the region, might be working in Southeast Asia, working in projects and communities to increase the standard of living, increase the economic development of those countries. So we start to get more of that parity when we have those discussions around trade.
I think the younger engineers do see it a bit more that way, but it's more the old school.
We live in a globalised economy, in a globalised world. You know, from a strategic point of view, geography is really important. You know, we've had the revenge of geography with the rise of great power politics, but overlaying that is the digital economy and the global economy that's not gone away. And you know, you have amazing transferable skills and opportunities that you've got to think, I think, in that mindset, think in that global and interconnected world mindset.
in some of the areas actually in South Asia, for example, in India, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka, what we've seen and where Australians have contributed is in science and technology. And many engineers, for example, from the ANU, from the engineering school, there's a big group of students and academics, they've gone to in rural areas in India, and they have worked with the rural community in terms of working on the solar power. And that actually also received a national award from India. It was incredibly positively, actually, it was publicized so in Indian media 4 or 5 years ago. So I think through that kind of connection, and then through Australian different programs, there was the Youth Ambassadors Program, but now we have the Volunteers Program. Many engineers actually connected with the region. So in science and technology, we see more and more Australian and South Asians, for example, connecting with each other. So I see your question, and I understand that there's a different kinds of anxiety, how free trade could actually also open up some of those questions about inequality within the systems, but also this tremendous opportunities that could be developed. That's what I wanted to just mention.
Okay. Joanne, did you have any last thoughts?
To say, don't mistake me for saying free trade is a good thing. For the Pacific Islands, I mean, I was talking about the PACER Plus. I don't necessarily think that Pacific Islands should sign up to a free trade agreement with Australia on the terms that have been offered without labour mobility. Because we need to remember that free trade is often negotiated on the terms of the wealthy country themselves, who use trade barriers to build their economies, and now they're imposing quite liberal trade regimes on countries that don't have that benefit. I think the important thing with free trade is it can be very beneficial to an economy, and it probably should be promoted, but it needs to come with assistance to meet the requirement. You were talking about the very strict requirements we have in Australian standards. That's a huge imposition on a Pacific island. I mean, I've done a lot of work on Tonga and their accession to the World Trade Organization. And it's somewhat ironic that you're standing in a very small Pacific island and they're developing incredibly sophisticated sanitary and phytosanitary requirements and standards within their government, yet, you know, education, health, electricity, basic things that we take for granted are a struggle. So please don't mistake us all as necessarily advocating free trade. I think it has to be free trade on more equitable terms than we often see.
Okay. Can you join me in thanking our five wonderful panellists for a very rich discussion?